As Kay alluded, a mother's love. Even the Lord said in Isaiah, somewhere, you know, can a mother forget her suckling child? No, but maybe they can, but I would never forget you. God says that his love for us is greater than a mother's love for her little infant child. So that's very assuring, isn't it? But celebrate your mums, thank them, spoil them today, every day. And until you become a mum, you will never know, or a dad, you will never know what it's taken to raise a little one. And your own appreciation for your parents will go through the roof when you experience the sacrifice of being a parent. Yeah. Well, it's my privilege this morning to bring you the word. And so far I've been walking through Philippians. And chapter one was the heart of Paul. His love for the Philippians, for the lost, and for Christ, which drove all those loves. In the second chapter, we saw the mind of Paul, the mind of Christ, humility and sacrificial service. And now, today, we're looking at chapter three, the first half of it, and it's called Paul's Goals. And it reminded me of the quote, if you aim at nothing, you'll hit it every time. So what are your goals in life? What are your goals in life? I remember doing that with a youth group one time, and Mia and I said we'd lead them for 2 weeks, maybe 3 weeks. It became 9 months because I kicked off with saying, what are your goals in life? What are you aiming for? And they wrote down their answers and they shared it. And God wasn't mentioned anywhere. And it really just broke my heart. So I shared with them a verse from this passage, Philippians 3:10. And that became our syllabus for the next, like I said, 9 months or so. But we're going to walk through Philippians chapter 1, verse 1 to 11. And it starts off with a warning. Paul writes, and if we can enlarge that so I have a better chance of reading it, that'd be great on the back screen there. So Paul writes, further, my brothers and sisters, rejoice in the Lord. There it is again, this theme that's unique to Philippians. Rejoice in the Lord. It is no trouble for me to write the same things to you again, and it is a safeguard for you. So Paul says, I'm going to keep on reminding you. I don't care if I sound like a cracked record. Repeat. I'm there to remind you of these important things. And then he says something quite strange after rejoice in the Lord. He says, watch out for those dogs, those evildoers, those mutilators of the flesh. My goodness, who is he talking about? And so he's talking about the circumcision party. And you read through the book of Acts, Acts 15, verse 1, Luke writes, certain people came down from Judea to Antioch and were teaching the believers, unless you are circumcised according to the custom, traditions taught by Moses, you cannot be saved. Yes, Paul was taking the gospel to the Gentiles. And these Jewish believers, or not quite believers, I'm not sure, were following him and saying, well, Paul only gave you part of the truth. Yes, you need Jesus, and that's good, but you also need the law of Moses. In fact, you need to be circumcised and observe all the law of Moses. That's the full deal. And these are the ones that Paul was referring to as dogs. Pretty harsh terminology. In fact, Paul's first letter was Galatians, and it was combating this all the way. He doesn't hold his punches back when he refers to these Judaizers and how they're in fact distorting the gospel. He says in Galatians 6, verse 12, those who want to impress people by means of the flesh are trying to compel you, that is, force or coerce you, to be circumcised. The only reason they do this is to avoid being persecuted for the cross of Christ. Yes, Paul is preaching Christ to the Gentiles without any reference to the law of Moses, and the Jews weren't happy. And they were going about persecuting Paul. They stirred up trouble. You read Acts, every city he went to, they stirred up trouble, the crowds, and had Paul imprisoned and beaten up and all sorts of stuff. And Paul was saying, well, these teachers are coming around, you know, flashing their credentials. And they're teaching the law of Moses as well as the gospel because they want to avoid the persecution. But they're glorying in your flesh, Paul says later in Galatians. The only thing I glory in is the cross of Christ. Now, why is it such a big deal? Answer, the whole gospel was at stake. The whole gospel was at stake. What sort of issues would have been a problem for the Jews to accept Gentiles, the non-Jews, as equals in the body of Christ? Here they are, they had 2,000 years of we are the people of God. 1,000 plus years of we have the law of Moses. We have the Sabbath. And the Lord really stressed the Sabbath in the Old Testament. They don't observe the Sabbath. What's the matter with them? These Greeks eat pork. Pork! Unclean food. You know, you do that back in our day, you'd have been stoned. We are the original people of God. Gentiles were dogs. Even Jesus said, no, you don't give your food, you give food to the children, not to the dogs, and referring to the Gentile dogs. So for them to accept these non-Jews as now equals in Christ was, whew, a big paradigm shift. Yeah? I mean, how can that be? You know, we've tasted the old wine, now you want us to accept the new wine, but the new wine is too different, perhaps. And so Paul talks about this a lot when he says verse 3, for it is we who are the true circumcision, I'll put that in myself, we who serve God by his Spirit, who boast in Christ Jesus, and we put no confidence in the flesh. If you're going to be righteous by the law, you had to keep the whole law. And who could keep the whole law? Nobody. You read Romans, you read Galatians, it's clear. We are all guilty under the law. The law condemns us. It does not save us. And Colossians 2, sorry to pinch from your script, Jim, 2:11. In him you also circumcised with the circumcision not performed by human hands. Your whole self, ruled by the flesh, was put off when you were circumcised in heart by Christ. And again, this isn't my main topic today, so I'm not going to stress it. But you read Galatians 3 and 4, and Paul talks about, it's not the circumcision of the flesh, one cut, that makes all the difference. It's the real circumcision is what happens in here. Lord, take all of me, okay? To cut off our whole old nature and be renewed within. So I think the lesson for us today is beware any form of legalism. Any form of legalism, and it's everywhere. Romans 3, 21, 22 says, but now the righteousness of God has been manifested apart from the law. How? Through, although the law and the prophets bear witness to it, the righteousness of God through faith in Christ Jesus for all who believe. For there is no distinction, Jew, Greek, we've all sinned. If we want to be right with God, the only way that is effective is through faith in what the Lord has done for us on the cross. And his last words were, it is finished. I have secured God's people for all time. And yet, so I want to say, there is no acceptable plus to faith in Christ. All you need is to understand and accept, repent of your sin, accept Jesus' death in your place, and God says, I forgive you. You are now clothed with the righteousness of Christ. And yet, the Catholic Church will say, faith and works. You've got to keep God's favour, earn God's favour. Well, I say to you, your works has nothing to do with your salvation. It's not the means of your salvation. It is the evidence of your salvation. So You can't add to what Jesus has done for you. It's not by baptism. If you know, there's some Protestant churches that say, you've got to be baptized to be really saved. So that is false teaching. The Jew, the criminal on the cross, today you'll be with me in paradise. Oh, be baptized first, arrange it quickly. No, that wasn't the case. Not tongues. What's been hitting the news lately, this guy Tilly, who wrote about his being brought up as a Pentecostal Baptist, a Pentecostal preacher's son. And he was taught, and they were taught, unless you speak in tongues, you're not saved. Well, that is a gross distortion of the gospel. It's just more of this, you've got to add to faith in Christ. There's nothing you can do to add to your faith in Christ to secure your salvation. Jesus has done it for you. Hallelujah. Like I say when I share the gospel, all you can say is, I'm sorry and thank you. That's all God wants. So Paul has said, watch out for these guys, because even his dear Philippians, he was hearing of their influence they were trying to have there in that church, in that whole region. Paul then digresses a bit. He doesn't digress. You see, he said, don't put any confidence in the flesh. And that brings on to the next bit where he says, though I myself have reasons for such confidence. If someone who thinks they have reasons to put confidence in the flesh, I have more. They want to boast about their credentials. I'm going to boast about mine, which we'll see later. He says it's a silly thing to do. But he says, I was circumcised on the eighth day of the people of Israel, of the tribe of Benjamin, a Hebrew of Hebrews. Pure thoroughbred. I could trace back my genealogy, he says. As regard to the law, a Pharisee, the most elite party. He was a member of the Pharisees and a leader. That's where he was heading. As for zeal, an attribute that Jews very highly prized. Zeal is good. Well, he was such a zealot. He was a persecutor of the church. He killed Christians and put them in prison, had them beaten up. You can't get more zealous than that. As to righteousness under the law, faultless. Wow. I mean, like I said, he was a Jew's Jew. He had it all. He had all the pedigree. He could flash his credentials. They think they're hot shots coming around, showing up their university degrees from the University of Jerusalem. Well, whatever they think they have, I have more. So if I want to play their game, I can match them. He was boasting of his pedigree because that's what they were doing. But, you know, we're going to see, Paul thought, well, all that is rubbish. I'll be honest with you, all that's rubbish. And it made me think that elsewhere, in 2 Corinthians 1, Paul also boasts of his qualifications. It's a bit of a digression, but it isn't. Let's see how Paul had changed from his pedigree, Pharisee, etc., etc. His other boasts he lists in 2 Corinthians 11, starting at verse 16. I repeat, let no one think me foolish, but even if you do, accept me as a fool, so that I too may boast a little. You see, there are people going around saying, Paul is not the real deal. So Paul had to assert his authority as an apostle. So he does it this way. What I'm saying, I say not with the Lord's authority, but as a fool in this boastful confidence. Since many boast of worldly things, I too will boast. You'll gladly bear with fools, being wise yourselves. You guys are being a bit tongue-in-cheek here. You guys are so wise, so just put up with me a little bit as I express my folly. For you bear if a man makes slaves of you, or preys upon you, or takes advantage of you, or puts on airs and strikes you in the face. That's what these hotshots were doing. Paul was meek. Paul never, you know, asserted his authority. And these guys were coming through acting like hot stuff. And they were being impressed. They were being misled by these, I'm going to say, false teachers. To my shame, I must say, we were too weak for that. I would never strike you to assert my authority. I would never put on airs and act like a hotshot. But whatever, he goes on to say, but whatever anyone dares to boast of, I'm speaking as a fool, as I also dare to boast of that. Are they Hebrews? And he goes through the same thing. Well, so am I. Are they Israelites? So am I. Are they descendants of Abraham? So am I. Very important to a Jew, son of Abraham. Are they servants of Christ? I'm a better one. Wow. Now, we saw last week, it's stupid to compare yourself to one another. That's why Paul is now being stupid and a fool. I'll compare myself to them. I'm a better servant of Christ than they are. What a sort of funny thing to say. How does he prove it? With far greater labors, far more imprisonments, with countless beatings, and often near death. Paul is now boasting of his credentials. He goes on to say, 5 times I have received at the hands of the Jews the 40 lashes less one. Remember Jesus received the 39 stripes? And the law said it's improper to impose 40. 5 times Paul was beaten, whipped like that. His back and his body must have been a mess. 3 times I've been beaten with rods. Once I was stoned. Remember they left him for dead outside the city? Who knows, maybe he was dead. But they went out and the church retrieved him. 3 times I've been shipwrecked. A night and a day I've been adrift at sea. On frequent journeys, in danger from rivers, danger from robbers, danger from my own people, danger from Gentiles, danger, my own people being the Jews, from Gentiles, danger in the city, danger in the wilderness, danger at sea, danger from false brethren, in toil and hardship, through many a sleepless night, in hunger and thirst, often without food, in cold and exposure, and he goes on. This is now Paul's boast. They think they're servants of Christ. What have they suffered for him? I'm the real deal. I've died, almost died many times in serving him. That was Paul's boast, no longer his uni degree, his Pharisee badge. See, Paul said, no, now I have new priorities, but I was up here, I was one of them, but what? But whatever was gained to me, I now consider loss for the sake of Christ. And the word loss is the Greek word zimia, damage, loss, detriment. Acts 27, remember that in the storm at sea and they had the cargo and Paul said, you're going to have to ditch the cargo. And they ditched everything at sea. And they counted it as loss. Forget it, it's a write-off. Paul said, all of that I have ditched at sea, it's a write-off. But that was sounds like once I was counted as gain, I've then counted as loss. But he still thinks the same. What's more, I consider everything as loss because of the surpassing worth of knowing Christ Jesus my Lord, for whose sake I have lost all things. I count them garbage that I may gain Christ. Now the Greek word garbage, skivalon, dung, sweepings, refuse, rubbish. You can think of the Aussie word that you would put there today. All that I count as valuable, it's crap. In comparison to knowing Christ. So it may be asked the question, what sort of things might we be called upon to count as rubbish for the sake of being Christ's followers? I'm going to give a personal example. Back in 1973, I met this really great girl. The first love of my life. Woohoo! And she became a Christian. That was great. But we knew that instead, when we met with God together, the focus wasn't this, it was that. And so we were challenged to split up, to be able to discern God's will. And we prayed about it on the 29th of August, 1974. Mia and I split up for 1 year to discern the will of God. I remember the date because I learned a verse that day that God had given me. Psalm 139, 23 and 24. Whom have I in heaven but thee? And there is nothing upon earth that I desire besides thee. My flesh and my heart may fail, but God is the strength of my heart and my portion forever. Psalm 139, 23 and 24. See, I was hanging on to Mia. And I was being convicted by the Spirit of God that she was an obstacle to my relationship growing with him. So he sort of said, Costa, who do you love more, me or her? Now, we discussed that day, well, let's split up for a month. And Mia said, well, what's a month? A month is nothing. We made it a year. I'm not going to give you the full story here. At the end of that year, I still didn't know. I think I saw her once that year at a conference. Then Mia got very, very sick, contracted rheumatic fever in hospital for weeks and weeks and weeks, and I went and visited her and fell in love again. And the next time we split up, it was for good. No time limit for God. You know, when Abraham was going to put the knife into Isaac, it wasn't a rubber knife. It wasn't 1 year, I'll come pick him up again. Okay, it was meant to be for good. So we split up for good. Anyway, the Lord led us back together again, and you know, that's now lovely. I won't say ancient history, it's current history, right? But I view that as one of the biggest lordship decisions of my life. So I had to take her letters and her photos and burn them, because I knew whenever I felt blue, I'd want to go back and reminisce. In which case, Satan would say, aha, you've never let go, have you? Yeah. So I didn't want to give Satan that opportunity. So yes, Paul said, all that I put behind that I may gain Christ. And I knew at that time I had to put that, my relationship with Mia, behind. It's the Spirit that gives life, the flesh is of no avail. That God had to resurrect our relationship. And he did, but that's a story for another time, better shared when Mia gives her half of the story too. So it reminds me of what's called the monkey trap. What are you holding on to that you need to let go? You know how a monkey trap works? Monkeys are very curious animals. And so what they do is they put a jar out there and they tie the jar to a tree or something or a stone. And the monkey puts his hands in, oh, a banana. That hangs on a banana, but the banana is too big to come out of the hole. In fact, its fist now makes it impossible to pull out of the hole. People walk up to grab the monkey. The monkey wants to run, but it won't let go. Stupid monkey. Do we sometimes do the same? God says, this is not a right relationship. This is not a right show for you to watch. These are not the right people for you to hang out with, or hobby to have, etc., etc. And if the Spirit of God says, I want you to let it go, because it's holding you back, my advice is, let it go. Count it as rubbish. God will give you something better. And I figured, sorry, honey, if you're watching this, I know you are. Oh, Mia is sick at the moment. Sorry, son. And if Mia wasn't the right girl for me, wow, couldn't wait to meet the one who was. Okay? That was not a very helpful thing for me to say to her, but I did, stupid me. I was so immature. I had a lot of growing up to do. There we go. This is why we split up. All right. Is there something you're holding on to that's holding you back. Now, don't do it because Costa said so or Jim said so, but if the Spirit of God is convicting you, listen. So what do you value the most? It made me think Matthew 13, 34, 35. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a merchant in search of fine pearls, who in finding one pearl of great value, went and sold all that he had and bought it. This is better than all the other stuff put together. Is that how we value Christ and our relationship with him and our service for him? So Paul said, I had all that going for me and really it's garbage. I let it all go. Don't be impressed by that. What matters is Jesus. And so we continue, verse 9. True, complete righteousness, I call this. And be found in him. You are in, if Christ is in you, then you are in him. Amazing. Not having a righteousness of my own that comes from the law, but that which is through faith in Christ, the righteousness that comes from God on the basis of faith. You are now in right relationship with God. You call him Father. He calls you my child. We call him Master. He calls us my doulos, my servant. I prefer child to doulos, but there we go. They're both true. So he says in Galatians 3, now it is evident that no man is justified before God by the law, for he who through faith is righteous shall live. Again, no one can keep the law 100%. Even James says that. So forget it. It doesn't work. You're going to need the faith that comes from God is through faith in Christ. The righteousness is through faith in Christ. So he says in Ephesians 4, you were taught with regard to your former way of life to put off your old self, your old nature, which is being corrupted by its deceitful desires and lusts, to be made new in the attitude of your minds, to put on your new self, your new nature, created to be like God in true righteousness and holiness. Remember the Pharisees thought they were righteous. And Jesus said, you're clean on the outside, but inside, ooh la la. You are a mess, dead man's bones. You cleanse the outside, the cup and the plate, but inside you're full of muck. Their righteousness was self-righteousness, which counts for nothing. But Jesus said to the people, unless your righteousness exceeds the righteousness of the Pharisees, you cannot enter the kingdom of God. Imagine how a Pharisee would have felt. What? Exceed my righteousness? Crazy. But yeah, Jesus is saying, the righteousness that I shall give you is greater than the righteousness the Pharisees think they have. Brothers and sisters, every time you muck up and there's a stain, what do? Oh, Father, I'm sorry. Take your spiritual soap, 1 John 1:9. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just and will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. You're clean. You are clean. Don't let Satan drive the opposite message into you to discourage you, to have you give up. So Paul says, now we are in Christ and Christ is in us and we are right with God. That's my treasure, Paul said. That's what I count as I'm blessed. Look, I'm proud to be a Greek, but in terms of my ranking, my values as a human being, it's way down there. I'm a child of God. I'm made in his image. That's the number one thing about Costa. That is my identity. That's not who I am, that's whose I am. That's a whole lot of things I could say, yeah? Mind you, I need to look at others the same way, with the same value, but that's another story. So what are Paul's new goals? Verse 10, I want to know Christ. Yes, to know the power of his resurrection and participate in his sufferings, becoming like him in his death, and so somehow attain to the resurrection from the dead. I see there three goals in verse 10. And I remember the day I was walking across the bridge at Swanston Street into Melbourne University. Reflecting on this verse, and bam, the following thoughts came to me. Reflecting on Philippians 3, verse 10. His three goals were this. One, that I may know Christ, a growing relationship with Jesus. That was his number one objective. I want to know Jesus more and more. I want to grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. Do you want to grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ? Or, yeah, I'm comfortable with where I'm at. This will do. Do you know God or know God? We are all still on the path learning. I don't want too many surprises when I get to heaven, you know, so to speak. I want to know God well now. Now, Paul's second goal, and the power of his resurrection. And what does that mean? It made me think, and I haven't got passages in Romans, but the power of his resurrection. You know, when we were baptized into Christ, buried with him, and risen to new life, I now live the new life. And I'm now, the righteousness is because Christ in me, not Costa trying to keep the law, tick the boxes. So a growing resemblance to Christ. I want to be, we sang it, we want to be more like Jesus. That's his second goal, a growing resemblance to Christ. Well, as I sat with that youth group and worked out what did that mean, we came up with a whole lot of attributes. God is love. Jesus is loving, humble, honest, just, merciful, compassionate. We wrote a big, long list of everything we think of, which became the basis of our Bible study for the next few months. When we look in the mirror, it'd be great if we could see more of Jesus. He must increase, I must decrease. Is there something in your life and in my life that we know? What would Jesus do? In the WWJD. Is that what he wants me to do? Is this pleasing to him or not? As I think I said recently, one of the first verses my little boys memorized was Colossians 3:23. Children, obey your parents in all things, for this is well-pleasing to the Lord. My behavior can either please God or displease him. Is there something in your life, my life, that when you do it, the Spirit of God goes, pfft. If you quench the Spirit, you will grieve the Spirit. And that's why we feel grotty when we sin. And his job is nudge, nudge. Hey, mate, did you feel that? Did you really get out of that what you thought you would? No. Well, let's work on stopping that together, shall we? Now, before you couldn't stop it because you were a slave to sin, but now you have me. You have the way of escape that you may be able to endure it. Trust me, obey me. Call out to me if you have to. But I want to make you clean. I want to make you holy. I want to make you like Jesus. That was Paul's second objective. His third objective, that I may share in his sufferings, becoming like him in his death. When do you suffer for being a Jesus, for being a Christian? When you speak up for him. You know, I was overlooked for a lectureship at Melbourne Uni, even though I was a senior tutor for a number of years. Why? Various senior members of staff can't get the bad taste out of their mouths of your Christian involvements. Okay. This little light of mine, I'm going to let it shine. And you know, keep it nice and quiet, no one will give us any grief. But if we stand up for him, people are going to say, what? You're joking. They raise their eyebrow and you go, oh no, I can't stand it. The persecution. I mean, we know in China, you speak up for Jesus, you can end up in big trouble. In the Middle East, you speak up for Jesus, you can end up in prison and beaten up and all sorts of stuff, right? They are suffering for their testimony for Christ. Here in Australia, well, we thank God for the freedoms. We'll see how long that lasts, actually, but that's another story, okay? We might suffer loss because we identify. But as you've already said, Paul said, I'll gladly suffer for Jesus. He says, another 39 whips coming up, I'll take it if I had to, if that's what God wants. Okay. A growing relationship with God, a growing resemblance to God, a growing identification. Paul said, they are my goals in life. And they ought to be our goals as well. I looked at that, and again, by the time I finished crossing over that bridge at Swanston Street, I thought, hey, that's to know Christ and make him known. Many Bible colleges have that as their slogan. To know Christ and to make him known. Known by the life that I live and known by the lip, by the testimony that I share. Make Christ known. They're my goals. They're Paul's goals. And I pray, brothers and sisters, that more and more they will become your goals. Now, I said more and more. Next week, we'll talk about this more and more. Now, Paul said, pressing on. Forget what lies behind, press on to what lies ahead. So, therefore, my beloved brethren, I always like to finish with that. What are you most, thinking of this passage, what are you most proud of about yourself? What is your boast? I'll be honest here and I'll confess. Sometimes I think about the things the Lord let me achieve at RMIT in sort of student programs and mentor programs and that, and it made a difference. I know it's all the goodness of God, the grace of God, but am I boasting about that? You know, and when I talk about it, do I give God the credit? Well, not always, because, you know, it's a secular audience. However, what are you most proud of? And then, well, how can you grow in your relationship with Christ? How's your Bible reading consistency? How's your prayer consistency? The quality of your worship? How can you grow in becoming more Christ-like? What are attributes you know that, yeah, I'm quick to grab the glory? Well, God doesn't want you to do that. Hands off the glory, God says. It's mine. And how can you grow in your willingness to suffer as a follower of Jesus? Are you hiding your light under a bushel? Yeah. I thought about how to finish today. And I hope the technology works for me. I'm a big fan of a guy called Keith Green. And here's one of his songs that I thought really fits the bill. If we go to the next slide, there's a YouTube link. And control click, and we'll have Keith Green end up for us. I hope it works, because if not, I have to sing it myself, and that's just not the same. No, I had it on the last slide as a, you know, purple control click, and it works for me at home. Does it not work here? On the final slide of the... okay, we're counting down 3, 2, 1. Well, maybe it's just not meant to be. No, I don't think so. Brent, on the last slide of the PowerPoint.
Yeah, sorry, I can't
have it. Okay. Well, Keith Green, what was the song called? I Pledge My Head to Heaven for the Gospel. Okay. It was with the words too. What a pity. All right, that'll do. While we're finding that one, I quote. That doesn't sound like Keith Green to me, but that's okay.
I wrote this song because it was easy for me to give up my life, but to think of my wife and my children who I love more than anything on the earth, to see them have to live in a different culture, or to see them have to be persecuted, or my wife beaten, or my son killed, was too much for me. And then the Lord had me put them on the altar like he had Abraham put Isaac on the altar. Ah, the thing that Isaac is famous for, being offered up by his father. Well, I pledge my wife to heaven for the gospel. Just seems to grow. As I told you when we went, I'd surely rather be found dead than to love her more than the one who saved my soul. Son to heaven for the gospel, though he's kicked and beaten, ridiculed and scorned, I will teach him to rejoice and let the thankful praising voice, and to be like him who bore the nails and crown of thorns. Son, I pledge my wife, I
Father, we thank you that you gave your one and only Son to die for us, to bear our sin, to shed his blood for the forgiveness of our sin. Lord Jesus, you gave everything. And now, Lord, you rose from the dead and you live in our hearts through your Holy Spirit. And now you ask us to live for you, no longer for ourselves. So Lord, help us to really think through the song we sang earlier, that we must decrease and you must increase. Father, help us to desire a deeper relationship with you, to grow in our knowledge of you, in our love for you, in our obedience, in our Christ-likeness of character. And Lord, to be willing to testify and to suffer for our faith as we share it with others. We thank you, Lord. We know that we can't do this of ourselves, but through your Spirit within us, that's your desire, your work within us, both the willing to work for your good pleasure. And Lord, might you have more of us, each of us, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.